In today's video, we're talking about penicillin and penicillinase resistant antibiotics. There's a few clues in this word I want to share with you today, so we're going to be capturing all of that right after this. All right, so we're talking penicillins today, and I've put a lot on the board here, and it may feel a bit overwhelming, but we're going to make this really easy for you today. So penicillin is the classification, and penicillinase resistant antibiotics is also the classification, these two drugs together. You'll notice at the end in cillin. So here we have penicillin G, penicillin V. This is a direct correlation right here. So the first penicillins to be used were back in the 1920s, and these were our classifications, penicillin G, penicillin V. Now they're used for gram-positive skin infections primarily, but you wanna make sure that the drug you're giving matches the illness. So you wanna go to your drug guide as a nurse and just check. And of course, penicillin G has got three other categories. Just to grab my book here, penicillin G benzathine, penicillin G potassium, and penicillin G procaine. So you want to make sure that you're using the right drug for the right reason. Now, what you can do to remember how they're given is penicillin G is given IVIM, always injection. So I think of the sign G in sign language, looks like a needle. And that's how I can remember pen G is injection. Penicillin V is oral. So take your V like scoops to put your food into your mouth. Okay, so there's one quick distinction that we can make just by looking at the word. Now, the other thing is it's the wall. The double L stands for wall in my brain. That's just how it works. So we're going to focus on the cell wall, which is the site of action. So when we have a healthy cell, we know that our cells reproduce and they create daughter cells, replications. When it's infected with bacteria, it does the same. And when we start to notice that we have an infection, we maybe have a fever, you've got some swelling, you've got redness, tenderness, you've got an infection in your skin, we're going to look to penicillin. Now, penicillin is site-specific, meaning it will not attach to a healthy cell and prevent a healthy cell from replicating. These are targeted to the bacteria cells. And when they attach to the receptor, they get inside the cell and they actually prevent that cell wall from replicating a strong cell wall. And so it starts to erode away at this cell wall. And because the pressure inside the cell wall is so great, it actually just bursts, it dies. We call that lysis. Cell wall death, lysis. But over time, bacteria have gotten a little bit smart to the ways that penicillin works, and they created penicillinase. So penicillinase is an enzyme, and it actually would prevent penicillin from reaching that cell wall so that it could continue to duplicate. Well, we couldn't accept that, could we? As a human race, what would we be if we accepted that first rebuttal? No. We need to up our game, right? So no is a clue. The next three drugs, no, we are not accepting this. Nafcillin, so you see it still ends in cillin. Oxacillin, methicillin. These were all created to prevent the enzyme that the bacteria had generated from stopping penicillin. So what the penicillinase resistant antibiotics do is they still can attach to the same receptor site, but they get around that. So they're not detected by penicillinase. So those are some really quick clues as to where you can find how to categorize these medications. So Noman, Nafcillin, Oxacillin, and Methicillin are the semi-synthetic ones that were created as a result of penicillins becoming ineffective. So we needed to trump bacteria, and we did. The extended spectrum, look at gram negative and gram positive, and that's ampicillin and amoxicillin. Now, how can you remember how these are given? Amp, vial, IV, amoxicillin is the oral version. Okay, so let's have a little bit of fun, shall we? I've changed the board, and on this side of the board are all the drug names I just talked to you about, and on this side are the three different classifications, penicillin, penicillinase resistance, and extended spectrum penicillin. I want you to pause this video. I'm going to hop out of the screen, pause this video, and match up those drugs with the type of penicillin it is. All right, did you get them? So remember our Noman, oops, there it is, Nafcillin, Oxacillin, Methicillin were all penicillinase resistance. Amoxicillin and ampicillin, we had to amp up for the extended spectrum, and pen G, pen V are penicillin. Excellent. Let's move on to the next piece. All right, so as we mentioned earlier, penicillin G has the three different kinds. Penicillin G benzathine is often used for syphilis and group A streptococcal URIs, upper respiratory infections. So these are fairly limited in its application at this point. Penicillin G potassium is, again, a natural penicillin, just like the others, and it is often used for things like anthrax, clostridial infections, diphtheria, and I think syphilis was also on here as well. Syphilis again, and serious streptococcal infection. All right, and then penicillin G procaine is again used for bacterial endocarditis. It can be used in diphtheria as an adjunct, and rat bite fever, streptococcal infections, where there are severe complications, and again, syphilis. So syphilis comes across in all the pen G. Penicillin V is used for pneumococcal infections, streptococcal infections, and Vincent infection, okay? Just to name a few. Penicillinase resistant, these are still gram-positive skin infections and no gram-negative coverage. It's the extended spectrum penicillins that have the gram-negative and the gram-positive. So like your UTIs, your E. coli's, those kind of things. Now these penicillins help to rid the body of bacteria that's causing infection. And so they're very selective in the cells that they will approach. So they will not enter into a healthy cell. They will only enter into the bacteria cell in which they have been pre-programmed to go after. So they are not effective against viruses such as the cold. They're only bacteria. So if you go in and you have a cold and you're asking for ampicillin, the doctor's not going to give that to you for a viral infection because it simply won't have an effect. All right, so when we come back to the word penicillin, in general, we have some commonalities among all of these three. The endicillin, every one of these drugs you recognize will be a penicillin of some sort. It affects the cell wall, so that's the two L's. That's where it has its site of action. Now, when it comes to side effects, we know that with all antibiotics, we can have nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, because there's a loss of some normal flora with the penicillin and the antibiotic use. But there's some important ones I want you to consider. So using pen as a clue when you're looking at side effects and things you need to look for, think of your light pen and how you need to look inside the mouth when you do an assessment. So anybody on penicillin, you should be following up to look inside to see if they have any infection of the lining of the mouth, if their tongue is swollen, or if there's a furry tongue. So the lining of the mouth would be stomatitis, the tongue swelling would be glossitis, and then the furry tongue is the other piece. And since we're talking about the mouth, they are given, the ones that are given orally, you want to give them without food ideally. Penicillins are sensitive to the pH in your stomach, so if you're on a pH inhibitor, you may want to talk about when would be the best time to navigate those two medications so that you can maximize the gastric acid breaking down the penicillin to get the effectiveness that we want. Now, of course, if it's causing too much upset, then you can take it with food, but ideally it's an hour before you eat or 2 hours after you eat. Okay? Now there's two classifications of drugs you need to know in order to make sure that they're not being given at the same time. Ideally, we want to avoid co-administering medications of penicillin with tetracyclines or with aminoglycosides. So tetracyclines will decrease the effectiveness of penicillin, and penicillin will decrease the effectiveness of aminoglycosides. So you want to be making sure you're talking with your doc if you're on both, or your pharmacist if you're on both. All right, I think it's time for an nclex question.
So the nurse is providing education to a patient about his new medication, amoxicillin. What should the nurse teach the patient about side effects? Pause this video now and consider the four options. If you guess C, your tongue may change color and look furry, that's the correct answer. Now, A is incorrect because we worry about diarrhea, not constipation. B is incorrect because tetracyclines need to be taken at a different time. And D is incorrect because a rash would potentially be an allergic reaction.
Now, if you have any tips on how to remember all the pieces around penicillin administration, drop them below. Now, if you haven't already subscribed, hit that subscribe, hit that bell, and we will see you in the next video. Make it a great day, guys.